2030, 2040, as long as we avoid the massive use of horrible weapons, I think we'll have a world that will be around. We're not going to disappear in any way. There'll be parts of it that'll look great, parts of it that'll look medium, and parts that'll look really bad. So I worry that what we're doing by increasing environmental stress on top of the usual human stresses is we're going to take the already badly stressed places and make them quite a bit worse. So if you're living in one of the better places, you'll say, what's the problem? It's just a little too hot. But if you're living in one of the poorer places that's very close to sea level, that air pollution really matters associated with the warmer weather and the extra fires generated by global warming, it's going to seem to be a pretty awful life. And if you care about some local species that are being driven off mountain tops and pushed toward extinction, you're going to be pretty upset. Or if you're an Inuit, you can't hunt out in the ice anymore because the ice is too dangerous to go on. It's too thin. It's as if your 5,000-year culture is melted out from under you. So what it's going to be is looking really bad to small island states and people on the cutting edge of the vulnerability. And for those who are living fat and rich and using the atmosphere to dump their waste, it's not going to look so bad at all. And they're going to say, what's the problem? And I expect that to continue. But that's 2030. Now, if we continue on this dangerous path that we're on toward tripling carbon dioxide by the end of the century, then we're going to make a commitment for then and the next century to warm up probably more than 3 or 4 degrees. And it's going to be pretty hard to find places on the Earth that won't be heavily negatively affected by that kind of change. So my worry about the political and emotional focus on a decade or two is it won't look that different. On the other hand, what we do in the next decade or two commits the long-term future to a radically different status of sustainability that we're leaving to our children, grandchildren, and the legacy for the rest of humanity and nature. So we have to have the vision to be able to see that our behavior in the next generation, even though it may not manifest itself as absolute detectable disaster in that time frame, can be creating the problems that really are, in my opinion, immoral for us to leave to future generations. And getting people to pay attention to what they do now about how it influences downstream is politically and psychologically difficult to do, but absolutely essential for proper planetary management. The greatest concern that many of us who study the impacts of climate change on human natural systems have is so-called tipping points. So what's a tipping point? A point, you go to the top of the hill, you come down, now all of a sudden you're going to keep accelerating until you go out of control and go off the road. So I like to, when I give my talks, ask the parents in the audience, so do you worry about your kids going in a school bus when it hits the top of the hill and comes down that they might get killed because it's going out of control? Of course they don't worry, because the school board has hired a good driver and they make sure they maintain the buses and they have good brakes. But what about the planet? In that analogy, the planet has no driver, just a bunch of teenagers fighting it out, and we don't even know if it has any brakes. So the problem that we have is that you can cross some thresholds and then start moving toward a completely new, unfamiliar, new state, and you might not even know it for 50 years. But once you've crossed it, you can't say, never mind, I changed my mind. I don't like having 5 meters of sea level rise from irreversibly having melted Greenland, which we could very well be doing over the next 10 to 20 years by continuing business as usual, even though we would not be certain we did it till maybe the end of the century, after which we've now committed the next 500 generations to have to move away from the coastlines and move literally billions of people costing trillions of dollars of infrastructure, destroying all the cultural heritage sites associated with being within 5 to 10 meters of the ocean, all the wetlands that are there. And what are we doing it for? In order to dump our tailpipe and smokestack wastes in the atmosphere for free so that we can get richer and richer only 1 or 2 years sooner in a century. It's crazy. Tipping points, of course, are very concerning because they deal with irreversibility. But some people correctly say, oh, but we're not sure where they are. How many degrees warming to melt Greenland? How many degrees warming to push species off the top of mountains into extinction? How many potential partial pH point drops will it take when you acidify the oceans by putting CO2 in the atmosphere before the coral reefs become largely destroyed? Well, nobody knows the exact number. So the optimists and the polluters and the deniers say, well, let's study it until we know. And of course, those people who care about the sustainability of our planet say, wait a minute, we have to be precautionary. We're talking about the life support system of the Earth being potentially threatened by small changes, which once you cross that point, you go irreversibly toward destroyed systems. Reefs are already in trouble from the release of toxic chemicals and fertilizer runoff, from people who fish inappropriately with things like dynamite and poisons, and they're in trouble from the warming of the oceans, which is bleaching them. Now you're going to add what we call a synergism, an additional factor that goes at the same time. And all that's going to do is make the threshold of concern even lower. So the synergism of warmer oceans, assaults on reefs just from the normal pressures of humans exploiting the resource, and acidification is going to make whatever the tipping point is happen sooner and at less stress. And the fact that we scientists have to tell the truth and say we don't know if that's 5 years from now or 50 doesn't mean that we should be taking a gamble. What are we going to do, wait around and see? Just think if an x-ray found a spot in your lungs and you don't want to do the surgery because it might be a little painful. Well, and expensive. So let's wait and see if the spot grows. If it grows, it's probably cancer. Better take it out. But supposing while you wait and it grows, it metastasizes, goes all over your body. Now it's too late to do anything. You're going to be dead. So the problem that we have is it is not cost-free to wait around to find out exactly where these tipping points are. Do we have 1 degree warming? Do we have 2? Do we drop acidity by 10%? Or can we go all the way to 50%? If we're going to sit there and wait for scientists to be sure of that, then we're performing an experiment on laboratory Earth with us and all the other living things along for the ride. My own personal view is that's just insane. Because why would we take that kind of chance on this planet? For what do we get? A little bit richer, a little bit sooner on the time frame of a century. That's not worth the risk. So therefore, what we have to do is say these tipping points, these so-called nonlinear events, what they tell us is we've got to get on with a job now that we should have gotten on with 30 years ago. And we have to do a little panic buying to be able to prevent the really dangerous outcomes that we're much closer to because we dropped the ball 30 years ago by saying it's too expensive. And now the same old forces of darkness are saying it's too expensive and we don't know because they don't want to lose market share in using the atmosphere as a free sewer to dump their junk. So in order to make them rich, they're perfectly willing to take the risk for the rest of the planet about its long-term sustainability. The only way we can stop them is to say no through government rules. Well, not everything that we're going to do is going to be bad. I mean, after all, if you're in the shipping industry, you can't wait for the Arctic sea ice to melt because you've got a shorter route across the Arctic. It's going to save fuel. In fact, it's going to even reduce a little bit of greenhouse effect by having a shorter route. And so you save money. Plus, there's going to be all those tourist ships going up to Greenland and viewing those beautiful spots up there in the Arctic. So if you're an economist, you're going to weigh the millions of dollars gained. And my God, we can look for oil. Look how much that's worth, never mind the spills. So they're going to go out and they're going to say it's a benefit. On the other hand, what happens when you melt the ice? You have a 5,000-year Inuit culture, which hunting on the ice will be destroyed. How do you, in a cost-benefit analysis, weigh an Inuit culture against shipping industry fuel expense? They're incommensurate. They're not tradable in markets. What about the polar bear ecosystem? How much is that worth? I once heard an economist tell me, as many dollars as people are willing to spend to visit them as tourists. Well, I think that's immoral. This guy thinks that's a professional judgment. I think he ought to look in the mirror and see if there's a moral person looking back at him. I mean, these are people locked in a profession that is heroically struggling to try to dollarize and discount everything as if everything in life is a cash flow transaction. Well, it isn't. There are moral judgments. We don't pick our family budget or even our country's budget based on a cost-benefit analysis. How much we spend on defense, on education, on health, on national parks, you know, on infrastructure. It's a value judgment about what society thinks is important. Now, once we've made the value judgment, please bring me the economists, because they can tell us how to do it cost effectively, and it's completely stupid to throw money away. You want to achieve that goal that society set on values as cheaply as possible. So we want the economists. We just don't want them making the decision on what to do, because it's not an economic judgment. It's a value judgment about what kind of society you like. If you're making a medical choice between a serious treatment with bad side effects and a serious disease, it's not the doctor's job to make that choice. It's your job to decide which poison you want to take. So the doctor's job is to tell you what the consequences are of alternative behaviors. Your job to figure out what to do. Exactly the same thing in dealing with the environment. How do you weigh the protection of a species versus the development of an economy? Well, those are legitimate trade-offs, and we need to do both. And there are tricks to try to do both, but we have to become aware of them and make trade-offs and make them explicit. And it's not only one way, and it's been dominated by one way, costs. That's been everything politically over the last few decades. And we've got to start changing that mentality and saying, what's important? Now let's get there cost effectively. That takes a mental change that's been evolving over a generation, and we've got to do it really fast, or we're going to run out of time to prevent a lot of dangerous thresholds being crossed with irreversible tipping points.